All righty, welcome back to another episode of the Discover Virginia Beach podcast, where we set out to discover, define, and do exactly what it is we're looking for in the Virginia Beach area. And today I'm joined by a special guest and friend of mine, Sarah Dodson. Welcome to the podcast.
Hi, Joseph. Thank you so much for having me.
Absolutely. Now, for those of you who don't know, Sarah Dodson is a business development manager at Prosper Insurance, which helps provide insurance coverage for business owners and individuals from home all the way to auto to help keep all of your assets protected and really cover all of your insurance needs. So today we're going to be diving into not only what Sarah enjoys about the Virginia Beach area, but specifically how to stay insured, especially in an area that is prone to storms and, of course, flooding. So with that said, we're going to get right on into it. So Sarah, I understand that you've been in the Virginia Beach area for quite a bit of time. Would you mind answering a question for me? And this is a question we kind of ask all of our folks on the podcast, and that is, what does community mean to you, and how has it played a part in building your life and your business here in the Virginia Beach area?
That is a wonderful question, Joseph. So what does community mean to me? So yeah, I've lived in the Norfolk area for the last 18 years of my life, which is basically half of my adult life, or all of my adult life, really. All of my adult life, half of my like full life here. So I have really made Norfolk my home. I come from Dublin, Virginia, which is a very teeny, teeny, tiny small town on the southwestern side of the state. Most people, I have to tell them it's near Radford or Blacksburg, where Virginia Tech is. And then they're like, oh, yeah, I know where that area is. But no one knows where Dublin is because it's literally just a map dot and a town of 2,000 people. So I grew up in a really like small, like kind of tight-knit community. We had one high school for the entire county. I had a pretty small graduating class, about of 100, maybe a little less. So we all kind of knew each other. And I think for me, I moved here to the big city of Norfolk, not knowing anyone and being really young. I was 20 years old when I moved here. And, you know, here 18 years later, I have built some really solid relationships with so many different people that I've met, not just through my job, but through friends, other jobs that I've had in the past, where now Norfolk kind of feels, and even like the whole area, kind of feels like a small town to me because I can go out anywhere and most likely see at least one person that I know. So I guess just for me, just feeling like I'm not like alone in like this big city and it feels overwhelming and large, but it actually feels, you know, more smaller. And I've got connections all over the place. So Norfolk in this area my home.
Well said on the Norfolk and Hampton Roads, Virginia Beach area piece. Dublin, Virginia. Okay. I did not know that about you. That's super fascinating. Especially because there are so many little towns in Virginia. It can be like super easy to overlook, especially as you look on to the western part of Virginia. And Sarah, you said something interesting I want to touch on and just clarify for our listeners. And if you've been listening to the show for any bit of time, or you're part of the Discover Virginia Beach podcast, you hear me say this a lot, and that is, excuse me, the Virginia Beach Facebook group. This is the podcast. Is Virginia Beach area is not just Virginia Beach. It's actually an accumulation of over about 10 different cities.
Yeah, like seven cities. Yeah.
Yeah. Seven cities in Hampton Roads. And then of course I love to include, you know, out there in Franklin, up in Williamsburg in the Eastern Shore area, where there's just so much to do. And that's something you can't ever really like put in a brochure or guide of just how connected you can be once you move to this area. It's just one, the highway systems are super fantastic. It just kind of connects you to everywhere with the bridge tunnels and everything like that, but just how integrated you can be. So I just want to, you know, kind of spotlight that, Sarah, because you kind of hit the nail right on the head when it comes to that. So I understand that you are in insurance, and we'll get into that in a moment, but I know you touched on, you were 20 when you moved here. What specifically brought you to the area? And If you wouldn't mind sharing some of your story that led you up into the point of getting into insurance, we'd love to hear more about that.
Okay, perfect. Well, I mean, as far as moving out here, it's as simple as I wanted to get out of my small town. love my family and everyone back there, but it just wasn't doing it for me, and not a lot of opportunity out there. So I was with someone at the time, and we decided to move out here together and moved to Willoughby, where I lived in Willoughby area of Norfolk for 10 years and have stayed in the Norfolk area. I now live in the Ghent area. Love it over here. Definitely more of like a city-ish vibe, urban feel and walkable. But I mean, no big reason other than I wanted to get out of like the really small town and move somewhere that afforded me more opportunities. By doing that, before getting into insurance, do y'all remember, Joseph, you might not, you're young. Do you remember
Happy to try.
Monster, where you would upload resumes to Monster?
I've heard of Monster.com. Yes.
Monster.com.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
So my first job I got working here was at Lynn Haven Mall, New York and Company. Pretty sure they're not open anymore, but the mall is. And I put my resume on Monster.com, and Long and Foster Real Estate Oceanfront Office reached out to me for a receptionist position. And I took it, and I worked within Long and Foster as a receptionist and an admin from 2006 until 2012. So 6 years. While in that position, Long and Foster, they have an insurance division, in-house insurance division, and they were looking for someone to be part of their sales team on the south side of Hampton Roads. And the vice president of the Hampton Roads region actually nominated me for that job. And I applied, and that is how I got into insurance. So I've always been in the real estate industry side, and then moved over into the insurance department of Long and Foster, where I was an insurance sales agent for all of the Long and Foster offices here on Southside Hampton Road. So that encompassed several in Virginia Beach, Norfolk, Chesapeake, and Suffolk.
Wow. And I did not know that about you. That's really interesting, just kind of how real estate plays its part in different ways of connecting people too. And shout out to Ghent. Yeah, absolutely. Very, very underrated part of Norfolk. So, and I'll do a quick pivot here. So if you are looking to discover what the Virginia Beach area has to offer, I actually created a super in-depth guide called the Relocation Guide, and it highlights all of the demographics and information. So if you're interested in that, just comment relocation down in the comment section below. And if you're like Sarah and you're like, okay, maybe I'm ready to get on my small town, whether that's in Virginia or another state, love to chat with you about what options are available here to you in the area, career-wise and activity-wise, and everything that goes along with that.
That's awesome.
So Sarah, I know you touched on this briefly, but I want to kind of start rolling into this next insurance side.
Okay.
Like, quick caveat, because I'm sure we have a few Swifties out there. I understand you and I were afforded the luxury of going to two separate Taylor Swift events. I took my wife and her friend, and you went to her concert as well. So needless to say, you are a fan of the arts and the music. And although Taylor Swift has yet to come and visit Virginia Beach, we won't hold that against her. But there are a lot of other great artists and musicians here in the area. So if you wouldn't mind, Sarah, are there any particular venues or places that where you enjoy going to listen to live music here in the area?
Yes, my absolute favorite is the Norva. I know everything I keep saying is in Norfolk, but I love the intimacy of the Norva. It's not like this huge venue. No matter where you are, you have pretty good, you know, eyesight to the stage, and the acoustics in there are just incredible. It's like every time I'm there for a concert, no matter who it is, I get lost in the music and absolutely love it. Feel like second, I don't know. I haven't been to the
Norva's the solid.
Norva's the solid.
That's the one you want to go to. And for those of you listening, it's N-O-R capital V
A.
Correct. Yeah. It's like two separate words with the capitalization, but yeah, it's everything from, I believe, alternative music, to like R&B soul. It kind of hits all of the notes, all the different crescendos.
All genres, and highly recommend if you're a big 80s fan, when the leg warmers come, go see the leg warmers. They dominate. And then the 90s cover band, the Bayside Tigers is their name. They're awesome as well. So
wonderful. Wonderful. Well, Sarah, I appreciate you sharing that. And definitely, as you said, you know, Norfolk is definitely one of those areas you got to check out if you're in the Virginia Beach area and you're maybe looking to explore beyond the oceanfront. That is definitely a place to check out. I just see Sarah's cat going back.
He really wants his 5 minutes of fame. Okay.
No worries at all. So Sarah, I know you mentioned you were with Long and Foster. You kind of transitioned from the real estate receptionist role to the insurance role. And I'd like to kind of head more into the insurance side, because I know a few folks probably listening are business owners looking to get insurance, or people looking to move to the area, looking to figure out what the insurance landscape is like. So with that said, I would love to start off this conversation by asking you, what is one of the most common misconceptions about insurance adjusters in general? And can you kind of steer us in a better direction away from those misconceptions into more so what you can expect when it comes to working with insurance adjusters?
Well, I mean, here's the thing. I feel like, you know, people think that the insurance companies, you know, have really high rates because they just want to take your money and charge a lot to have the policies. And that's really not what it is with insurance. You keep saying this is protection. It's all about protecting your assets, your investments. And really the goal is to have insurance and hopefully never use it. And while rates can increase over those times for a multitude of reasons, whether you filed a claim or, you know, haven't had any accidents in a while, you know, there are reasons that rates rise. Right now, one of the reasons, you know, that we're seeing, you know, nationwide, it's not just here in Hampton Roads, it's nationwide, you know, the cost of building materials have gone up. So the cost to rebuild a home has also gone up, which takes your overall dwelling coverage a little bit more expensive, which can raise your rate. So I think just a misconception is knowing that your insurance agent is really trying to do the best for you in protecting your investments and your assets, and not trying to charge a lot of money to make a lot of money, because there's really, sure, we don't make a lot of money.
That tees me up perfectly to my next question, Sarah, and that is cheaper always better when it comes to insurance? Because when I'm shopping for my insurance, especially, I'll call myself out, I'm looking for the cheapest rate possible. Would you mind identifying with some ways to go about shopping for insurance, and also highlight why going the cheapest route may not always be the best option? Speaking to somebody who thinks that the cheapest route is always the best option.
And look, I get it. The bottom line is so important, and we want to cut back on our expenses and our spending as much as possible. So I'm not saying that you shouldn't shop to find the best rate. I think what you need to look at, other than just that bottom line, is look at what your coverages are on that policy. You know, whether you own a home or you're renting a home, look at what the coverages are for your home. Look at what the coverages are for all of your belongings inside. Like if you were to experience a total loss and a loss of all your personal property, is the coverage that you have adequate to replace your items or replace your home in the event of a total loss? God forbid. The liability coverage, make sure that's a good amount. And then one way that you can, you know, take a look at price versus like your deductible. So your deductible can help influence the rate, whether high, like increase it or decrease it. So maybe if someone is comfortable, the typical homeowner's insurance deductible is $1,000. I'd say for your auto, the typical is $250 to $500. Now, if you're someone that, you know, feels comfortable having a higher deductible, you can increase that deductible and it will lower that, you know, overall rate of your policy. However, one thing in Hampton Roads to be aware of is we live in a coastal area. So a lot of the insurance policies have separate deductibles for, there's a few different ones. There's wind and hail. So that encompasses any type of storm that involves wind or hail. So anywhere from a thunderstorm to a hurricane. Those deductibles can be anywhere from 1% of your dwelling coverage all the way up to like 5% of your dwelling coverage. And you want to make sure that you are reviewing your policies and talking to your agent to find out exactly how much that deductible is, because you could have like a $5,000 wind and hail deductible and not even know it, and then experience a loss, and then crap, I don't have $5,000 to pay towards my deductible to have the necessary repairs done. So working with a company that understands and educates and guides the client so that they know exactly what they're getting, exactly what they're paying for, and they feel good about it.
Sure, sure. Yeah, and Sarah, I appreciate you elaborating on that, because it is easy to only look at that bottom line. But just like when it comes to, I don't know, purchasing something off the shelf at a grocery store and the price tag says $2.99, it isn't always going to be $2.99. There's a lot of factors and sales tax that go into that. So it's definitely, sound from what I hear you're saying, is having a person to speak to about all of those back end costs that go into setting the deductible, setting your limit and your cap, so to speak. That way, in the event that something inevitably happens, you know what your output is going to be on that initial cost to get everything.
Exactly. Okay. Exactly. I do business development. So my role with our company is to work closely with loan officers and real estate agents, helping them with growing their business, growing their sphere, and but also being their reliable insurance partners that they refer their, you know, clients to when it comes to the home purchase. Because as you know, being a realtor, one of the items you have to have in order to go to closing is homeowners insurance. So we want to be that partner that they're sending their clients to. And then, you know, we work with them and, you know, handhold them through the insurance piece of the process.
Gotcha. So I'll just collectively say insurance, if that's okay.
Yep.
So when it comes to general insurance and times of crises, is there something unique about Prosper Insurance and how they take and support businesses during those times, especially when it's of, you know, critical nature?
Yeah, absolutely. And one thing that makes us super unique at Prosper is we have our own claims advocacy department, which is basically, we built this entire department, and basically, let's say, Joseph, you experience your roof gets ripped off during that, like the tornado that happened recently in Virginia Beach that no one really thought was coming. You call us, Prosper. You don't have, so we work with like 30 different insurance providers. We're a brokerage. So instead of calling like the individual insurance company yourself, you would reach out to Prosper. You would get to our claims department once they find out that that's why you're calling. And then one of our claims advocates will really kind of be the liaison between you and the insurance company as far as it goes. Like, do you really need to file a claim? Because a lot of times maybe a water heater bursts and there's minimal water damage done in a home. Maybe that's not necessarily you want to file a claim for, especially if you have a $1,000 or $2,000 deductible. You know, we will, you know, be consultative with you on that. Whether if you call the insurance company, you say the word, I think I might want to file a claim, it's going to go on your insurance record. And even if it's a zero paid out claim, it can follow you and be on there for a while and, you know, make you a little less attractive to insurance companies when you're collecting insurance. But if you do want to move forward with filing a claim, you know, the advocates will help schedule remediation, get the adjusters out there, and just make sure that claims are taken care of quickly and fairly for our client. I mean, we want to do best by our clients. We are customer like centric. And again, it just comes back to our clients feel good about their insurance and feel taken care of.
Wow. That's so interesting. So there's actually an exclusive department specifically that you have for facilitating, more so than just a call center. Cause I know a lot of times people I've talked to in the generic big box insurance companies, you call And then it's just transfers directly to, like you said, setting up the insurance policy, filing the claim, so to speak.
Right.
So it's nice that you guys provide that service to customers for really deliberating what exactly needs to be taking place.
Exactly.
The options that they have. So that's really awesome. And so as we kind of head into this next segment, this is kind of related to it, especially when it comes to how information is, you know, not only communicated from the client to the insurance side, but also how the information is being recorded. Because as you and I know, Sarah, we're not even meeting in the same room right now. We're talking digitally. So technology and, you know, a lot of systems are automated now. So I would love to know from your perspective, the insurance industry is often seen as kind of like in real estate as a traditional business. But there have been a lot of discussion recently about, you know, the way technology is changing the field. Could you share from your perspective how technology has impacted your role, you know, from the business development side and also on the claim side, and what you foresee happening over across the industry, like over a wide scale? Like what does that look like as more technology comes into place?
That's a really great question. And as far as like what's to come, like, I mean, I have no idea. I will tell you that, you know, once, you know, when we were kind of in lockdown, my job is being in front of people. My job is relationships. So I was out and about every single day. I didn't sit in an office. I was going into other people's office. I was meeting people for lunch and coffee, and we were hosting, you know, educational events. And, you know, we really had to rely on technology and relearn, you know, or not relearn, but learn how to continue to perpetuate these relationships and our offerings to our referral partners online. I got great at videos and sending videos to people as like my new like pop-in office visit and see people. We do even now a ton of educational events via Zoom. I teach CE courses for realtors. And while most of them now are in person, still people will request to have them done online. And I'm able to do it across the whole state of Virginia or down in North Carolina and not have to travel. So technology has been huge, and we are still using it, you know, outside of, you know, being in lockdown. As far as the sales agents go, you know, Prosper, we don't really have an app that we use for people to go on and get a policy. We believe in talking to the client, understanding their unique and personal needs when it comes to insurance, and being able to, you know, dig deep and make sure they are super covered. So our agents, they are talking on the phone to the clients, you know, old school. Some will communicate via email if, you know, someone is overseas. But as far as like a real technology takeover for insurance, I mean, my hope and belief is that relationships are still going to remain, you know, hugely impactful and key when it comes to our part here in Hampton Roads.
Wow, absolutely. Absolutely. And I would say that's a testament to not only your personal philosophy, but also Prosper's philosophy on insurance as well, because at the end of the day, I mean, when you're talking about your home and your assets, it's probably worth a phone call. It's worth an in-depth conversation, at least to some extent, right? Because I know sometimes, you know, you can email over quotes, estimates, summaries, and information. Like that part of it is something you can relay over video and text, but actually going through, okay, how many homes do you have? How many pets do you have? How many children do you have? How many, you know, individual investment accounts do you have, just to make sure you're being a good steward of your resources? Like, it's worth having that phone call.
Exactly. You want to have all the correct information. There are no surprises later on.
Yeah. So with that said, that leads me into my last question here. And that's going to be, it's going to be a broad question as far as the general term of gray area, but I do know things happen in the industries, you know, across different sectors that could be misconstrued or misunderstood as a gray area. So for you specifically, Sarah, has there been an instance, whether you're working on the business development side or possibly facilitating in cases where you came across something interesting on your desk that was not normal or out of the ordinary, generally speaking, in the insurance world, that was unique to Hampton Roads that you could maybe touch on and share with us about maybe a general process that you use for going to figure out how to go the extra mile for that client.
I mean, I don't want to say it's like really anything unique, but I will say something to be aware of and where, you know, our insurance agents really shine and are shine rather and are subject matter experts is flood insurance. We live in a coastal area. You know, I teach CE on flood, really well versed, and I will tell you that there is no such thing as a no flood zone anywhere in the United States. You have your low risk zones and your high risk zones. We've had a lot of remapping over the last, you know, 6 to 10 years where areas that weren't considered high risk are now considered high risk. And I mean, I would just say always make sure you're looking at the flood zone of the home that you're purchasing or where you're living right now, and then talk to your insurance agent about getting a flood insurance policy, whether you're in that high risk or low risk zone. Because again, if you experience damage from a flood, your homeowner's insurance does not cover it. It is not covered at all under your homeowner's insurance. It is completely separate. So knowing what your zone is, having like a low cost policy, I feel like is going to, you know, give you peace of mind and save you any headaches down the road if you were to somehow experience flooding. And there's a lot more options now than just FEMA. Private insurance companies also now offer flood insurance. And again, I said our agents at Prosper are flooding subject experts. They deal with it all of the time.
So great tip. Great resource as well, Sarah. I appreciate you sharing that too, because we are in a coastal area and a little bit of extra rain, whether you're in Portsmouth, Suffolk, or you know the Chesapeake area, we do experience some flooding most of the time being in a coastal area. So it's definitely good to have that blanket policy if you are, you know, have any concern whatsoever. Sarah, this is, as we wrap up today's conversation, I'd love to share and highlight maybe some special projects you have going on within your business, whether that's on the business development side or looking to connect with business professionals, because here in the Discover Virginia Beach podcast, we have locals and tourists alike looking to discover everything Virginia Beach has to offer the area in total. So would you mind sharing where people can go to connect with you and any special projects you want to highlight as we head out of the summer?
Yeah. So, I mean, you're going to put my contact information in here?
Yeah, it'll be in the show notes, but definitely want to, you know, highlight the audio as well.
Yeah. So you can contact me, sdodson@prosper.insurance. I'm also on Instagram and Facebook, and my Instagram handle is sarahdodson84. Instagram, find me on there, and Facebook, Sarah Nicole Dodson, on Facebook. As far as special projects, you know, not really anything super special for me right now. Just continuing to connect with my current, you know, partners and clients that I work with and help them with their business. This isn't necessarily a project, but it is one thing I did not mention that makes Prosper unique, which I feel like is one of the most exciting things we do and not a lot of people know about. So I want to make sure I always bring it about is we plant a tree for every single policy that we write. We really believe in giving back to the environment. So we partner with One Tree Planted and Sea Trees. And the coolest part is that our clients get to choose where their tree is planted. So they can have it planted in the rainforest, or they could have it planted by the ocean. And to date, we've planted over 86,000 trees. Our goal is 1 million. So that's the special project. Help us get to 1 million trees planted.
That's incredible. Sarah, thank you for your time. If you're looking to learn more about what Sarah has to offer or just connect for a conversation or general insurance questions, she's a tremendous resource. And I've definitely, you know, Sarah, you can second this as well. Feel free to reach out to her. And that's Sarah with an H, by the way. I've made that mistake. With an H on all social media platforms. And of course, show information will be in the show notes. Go out there, talk with Sarah, hopefully plant a tree. And Sarah, thanks again for your time. I really appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me. I appreciate it, Joseph.